Hi everyone, it's Dr. Campbell and I am back with another ICD-10 CM coding guidelines review. We are still climbing our way through our chapter specific guidelines, and today we're going to focus on chapter 10, which are the diseases of the respiratory system, codes J00 through J99. In this code family, we're going to begin with codes J44 and J45, which represents codes for COPD, or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and asthma. These two code families have the ability to distinguish between uncomplicated cases of these two conditions, as well as those situations when the patient is in an acute exacerbation. Acute exacerbation, very simply put, is a situation where a patient has a chronic condition and it is getting worse. It's no longer stable. Of note, acute exacerbation is not equal to an infection that is superimposed on a chronic condition. However, an exacerbation can be triggered by an infection. Next up, we're going to look at acute respiratory failure. And first up, we're going to start with acute respiratory failure as principal diagnoses. As you should know by now, principal diagnoses is the condition that's established after study to be chiefly responsible for occasioning the admission of the patient to the hospital. So as it relates to acute respiratory failure, which is code J96.0, as well as subcategory J96.2, which is acute and chronic respiratory failure, these two codes can be sequenced as principal when they meet the definition of a principal diagnosis, and of course is supported by the medical record documentation, as well as the alphabetical index and the tabular list. Of note, there are some specific chapter guidelines that may take precedence over sequencing acute respiratory failure as principal. Some examples are situations for obstetric patients, poisoning, HIV, and newborn cases. Acute respiratory failure as a secondary diagnosis. Now, this condition can be listed as a secondary diagnosis if it occurs after admission, or it is POA, or present on admission, but does not meet the definition of principal diagnoses. Lastly, for respiratory failure, we're going to look at sequencing of acute respiratory failure and another condition, and specifically another acute condition. When the patient is admitted with respiratory failure and another acute condition, the principal diagnosis is actually not going to be the same in every situation. This applies to whether the other acute condition is a respiratory or non-respiratory condition. Your first listed code or your principal diagnosis is going to be dependent on the circumstances of the admission. In those cases, if both the respiratory failure and the other acute condition are equally responsible for the admission today, and there are no other chapter-specific sequencing rules, then we're going to follow the guidance under selection of principal diagnoses, which basically states when two or more diagnoses equally meet the definition of principal, either can be sequenced first. In those cases when we're not sure as to whether or not acute respiratory failure and another condition are equally responsible, this is when you want to query the provider for clarification. Next up, influenza due to certain identified influenza viruses. Now, here we're going to see an exception to guidelines. So with these types of conditions, we can only code confirmed cases of influenza. And this is related to category J10 and category J09. And this is an exception, again, to our hospital inpatient guidelines. Of note, guidelines tells us that confirmation doesn't necessarily have to be a positive laboratory testing finding. The provider, based on his clinical judgment, can say that this patient actually has influenza. Of note, if the provider says suspected, possible, probable, I think it is, it looks like it could be, we should assign J11. Now you see the difference between J09, J10, and then J11. A code from category J09 and J10 would not be assigned if he says, he or she says, probable, suspected, I think it is, it could be. Last guideline for the respiratory system diseases, and that is around ventilator-associated pneumonia. So as you know, patients that have difficulty breathing on their own can be intubated and placed on mechanical ventilation. So as with all procedural or post-procedural complications, our code assignment is going to be based on the provider's documentation of the relationship between the condition and the procedure. So first up, we're going to look at code J95.81 and its associated guidelines. So number one, J95.851 should only be assigned when the provider has documented ventilator-associated pneumonia. You can also use an additional code for the organism if it is known. Note, do not assign a code from categories J12 through J18 to identify the type of pneumonia, as this is specifically ventilator-associated pneumonia. This code also should not be assigned for cases where the patient has pneumonia first and is on a mechanical ventilator and the provider hasn't stated that the patient has ventilator-associated pneumonia. The provider has to make that connection. And lastly, ventilator-associated pneumonia that develops after admission, this is category J13. So a patient can be admitted with one type of pneumonia, such as category J13, streptococcal pneumonia, and then subsequently develops ventilator-associated pneumonia. In this instance, the principal diagnoses would be the appropriate code from category J12 to J18, because those are your pneumonia codes, and then code J95.851 would be assigned as an additional diagnosis when the provider states that the patient has ventilator-associated pneumonia. So you see here, the key is the documentation. The devil is always in the details. All right, guys, thank you so much for listening. And when I come back, we'll take a look at Chapter 12, Diseases of the Skin and Subcutaneous Tissue. Happy coding!